What are the purposes of musicology? An understanding of musical texts, of their formal structural aspects, of their meanings, of theories, practices, and technologies involved in music creation, of the historical, economic, social, gender context in which music is made, and so on and so forth. Some musicologists would subscribe to all purposes mentioned. Others would pick one or a few of them. But what about practical uses of musicology? Uses related to the economic interests of people involved in music creation and dissemination. These are the kind of uses that so-called forensic musicology has been dealing with for decades. Would musicologists object to such uses? It would be surprising, as physicists, chemists, doctors normally do not object to the use of their knowledge to detect crime and or solve legal cases. And moreover, experts in literature, visual arts, cinema, games are involved as forensic consultants in cases of plagiarism or forgery without objections. I would also suggest that forensic musicology is a misnomer, as there is no forensic physics or forensic genetics, but the application of physics or genetics to the solution of legal cases. So, forensic musicology must simply be intended as the usage of musicological theories and methods to solve legal disputes. This is important because when we discuss forensic musicology, we are discussing musicology per se, musicology tout court, not a special branch of it. Although, of course, some musicological theories and methods are used more frequently than others in forensic applications. The purpose of this paper is not to discuss the ethical implications of musicology's forensic applications, but to investigate how musicologists are involved in such practices, how different trends and ideological foundations in music scholarship confront in courts, as they do in the academy. And also, given that the majority of cases dealt with are about popular music, if popular music scholars are actually consulted by courts. The positivist overtones of modern musicology are known, commencing from the name of the discipline, the suffix ology and its equivalent in various languages, or even the definition as science in the German term Musikwissenschaft. A combination of positivism and Darwinism is at the origin of the best known systematic definition of musicology's scope, methods, and objectives given by Adler in 1885. Music historians, as well as science historians, also know that the development of modern musicology and the turn from theories and practices strictly associated with mathematics and physics to the scientific study of music aesthetics, that is, to an independent science of music, is coeval with a revolutionary change in fundamental music categories that occurred between mid-18th and mid-19th century. Matthew Gelbart has effectively described the inventions of the concepts of folk music and of art music. He and Derek Scott have shown that popular music became the name of the residual semantic space, including all music that wouldn't fit into the other main categories. Get Back also related the creation of those categories to an irreversible shift from the Aristotelian and medieval value criteria, the adequacy of style to the subject and function of a work of art, still operating in European music in the first half of the 18th century. Remember the judgment by Father Martini about Pergolesi's Mass, stating that it was written with the style of his comedy La Serva Padrona. And from these criteria, based on the theory of the three styles, the Rota del Giri and such other theories from the Middle Ages, changing to criteria based on the origin of a work, be it an ancient bard like Ossian, or a peasant, or an artist, or a genius. All such changes, then, are related to new developments in the concept of authorship, which in turn are connected with the almost simultaneous development of copyright and music publishing. And here we come to plagiarism and to its usually underestimated relations with modern musicology and Western musical thought. We have seen, in fact, that far from being a marginal subject of interest for today's musicologists, forensic musicologists, plagiarism is a concept and a practice that simply can't be thought of outside the musical value system developed in the West between mid-18th and mid-19th century. Dictionaries define plagiarism as the practice of taking someone else's work or ideas and passing them off as one's own. And it is clear that concepts of intellectual property or ownership are inextricable from such a definition. In many cultures, not only musical cultures, an author does not exist. Or if the idea of the property of, say, a piece of music exists, it is articulated differently from classical or popular music concept. In traditional, orally transmitted music culture, in the blues, for example, as Alan Lomax noted, someone can be credited as the owner of a song, in the sense that the song is said to be his or hers, but that means that the musician is a bearer of that song, someone who inherited that song, or made it popular, or has it in his or her repertoire. Not necessarily that he or she is the composer or wrote it, even if this cannot be excluded. It is also well known that even in pre-classical European music, before the development of the modern idea of the author genius, the music of other composers was appropriated and manipulated without ethical, legal, or economical scruples, even by artists like Johann Sebastian Bach, who were later transformed into the symbol of the modern author whose works are deemed to be inevitably unique and original. Plagiarism, then, is an incorrect criminal practice only within the temporal and societal context where it has been implicitly defined as such. Moreover, as we shall see, a clear-cut distinction between appropriation and imitation is not always easy to draw, and definitely imitation plays an important part in creative processes. Harold Bloom, in his work The Anxiety of Influence, What is commonly referred to as influence was described by literary critic Harold Bloom as an active practice in terms of emulation, imitation, or sheer copying on the side of the influenced artist. Bloom would also comment that usually stronger artists steal, while weaker artists are influenced. And even if Bloom's hierarchy seems to be old-fashioned today, his suggestion of the reverse action of influence from the influenced to the influencer is consistent with many compositional practices, from the usage of models like Bach's chorales or Mendelssohn's Lieder ohne Worte in the teaching of composition, just expected to imitate that style, in the or for a very recent example, to Elvis Costello's technique of writing new songs on the blueprint of old Motown singles. Plagiarism is copying blatantly, without erasing the traces of the copying or doing so goofily. Discovering and highlighting such processes in the ocean of intertextual references that anyway exist in music practice today and in the past is typical of the forensic musicologist's work. As we have already seen, what distinguishes forensic musicology from musicology per se is the fact that musicologists' theories and methods be applied to a legal dispute. And this is not only the case of plagiarism, but also of matters of authenticity or forgery, although such cases are more common in other arts than music, for example, in painting and visual arts. The recent discovery that the celebrated Für Elise was most probably created by musicologist Ludwig Knoll, who published the piece in 1867, on the basis of some of Beethoven's sketches included in the composer's technical notebooks, and so isn't a piece by Beethoven, but from Beethoven, is an exemplary result of a music philological analysis supported by a deep knowledge of Beethoven's compositional and performing style. It is a remarkable achievement of contemporary historical and analytical musicology. It would become a case of forensic musicology if, for example, Knoll's estate went to court arguing for defamation of their ancestor. But we shall see that bringing Für Elise to court isn't as absurd as it seems. Going back to plagiarism in music and entering into more detail, it can be useful to remove from the field a few popular assumptions. Many believe that plagiarism, as such, is defined by law, copyright law in Anglophone countries, or droit d'auteur, diritto d'auteur, and so on, in many other countries. And that law also establishes a minimum amount of the plagiarized work included in the supposedly plagiarian work as the threshold beyond which plagiarism is positively ascertained. For example, a certain number of notes in the melody of a song, or a certain number of bars, the most common opinion being that it must be 8 bars or 4 bars. These assumptions are false. First, plagiarism is not defined in copyright acts or in laws on droit d'auteur. Plagiarism is just one of many possible infringements of copyright or droit d'auteur. In the Italian legge sul diritto d'autore, the copyright act for Italy, a very long text, there is no occurrence of the word plagiarism at all. Second, a quantitative threshold for plagiarism is never mentioned anywhere. Plagiarism is mentioned in court sentences, of course. Here's an extract. I will show this translation of mine from a sentence from the tribunal from Bologna about a famous case of plagiarism in Italy. And I try to render the kind of jargon of the judge. Plagiarism consists in the appropriation of the creative elements of someone else's work, as it isn't enough that one or more ideas present in one of the works under comparison be found also in the other. but it is necessary that in the work created later, one can find a real transposition of the individualizing nucleus that characterizes as original the supposedly plagiarized work. On the one hand, what has to be intended as creative elements or individualizing nucleus is actually at the core of the debate during the discussion of plagiarism cases, especially about music. On the other hand, creative character and originality or novelty are basic requisites for a work in order to be protected under copyright law. Lawyers and consultants defending supposed plagiarists make use of such requisites to reject allegations preliminarily, either by negating the creative character of the original work or by searching for other preceding works that present the same creative elements. Here is an example from another famous case. It involves an Academy Award winner for the soundtrack of a movie years ago. Creative character and novelty are constitutive elements of an author's right on his or her intellectual work. It follows that before verifying if a work may be the result of plagiarism of another, the judge must verify if the latter meets the requirements to benefit of the demanded protection, and this both under the point of view of expressive completeness and under the point of view of novelty. These technical details, which of course are neither details nor technical, as they belong to the philosophical core of copyright, lay at the basis of different judgments on supposed plagiarism case by lay people on the one side and experts on the other. A typical case of divergence between common competence and analytical competence, as Italian music semiotician Gino Stefani would put it. It isn't uncommon that plagiarism cases that were initiated by a wave of popular indignation end up differently from expectations, as the judge of the court value that individualizing nucleus of the preceding work wasn't transferred to the following one, or that the preceding work wasn't fully developed as a work, or wasn't actually new. It goes without saying that such aspects are intensely, even ferociously, debated between lawyers and technical consultants involved in plagiarism cases. The issue is crucial to many respects, as it is also related to diverging musicological theories. For whom are the similarities or identities relevant? For the wide audience or for experts and professionals? And where such similarities or identities must be located? In the recorded version or in the score? And which score? The answer would be difficult anyway on a purely theoretical ground, but it is complicated by the fact that the economical consequences of plagiarism, and hence the amount of compensations demanded by the authors and publishers of a plagiarized song, are based on the sales of records, on broadcasting rights, on live performances, much more than on today's almost irrelevant sales of printed scores. So, whatever an expert and the history of copyright may say about structures that can be identified in a score, the economical consequences are based on listening by the crowds. Spotting a case of plagiarism has been a popular sport for decades. Big festivals like the Eurovision Song Contest or the Sanremo Festival in Italy or others, or the publication of new expected albums being focal moments. Moreover, in the age of social media, the news are spread almost immediately, quite often supported by YouTube videos where the relevant songs are juxtaposed or superimposed with a significant amount of technical skill, like transposing pieces in order to compare them in the same key, and slowing down or accelerating in order to synchronize them. And these videos are frequently prepared by the very authors of the supposedly plagiarized song, or by friends or fans. It has become common practice that lawyers and consultants use the number of likes obtained by such videos as an argument in favor of their clients, the plaintiff. Before returning to the theoretical implication of such controversies, which will be examined in detail on the basis of actual lawsuits, let's examine a summary and necessarily incomplete typology of plagiarism cases and their origins. First type, it is rather common that an unknown songwriter sends a demo to a famous artist or a producer or a publishing or a record company in order to have a song published and or recorded. It may happen that later that song or a similar one is released by the artist, producer, or music publisher, record company without crediting the original songwriter, and that it becomes a hit. This is the reason why many record companies and publishers do not accept unsolicited demos, although a proof of contact isn't generally relevant in plagiarism cases. It is so, I think, in the United States, but I'm not sure. A variant of the above scheme is that an unknown songwriter submits a song, often fully produced, to a minor song contest or an exhibition, a showcase, and so on, which people in the music... Which people in the music business are supposed to attend. And later, the song or a similar one is published under another name, sung by a different performer, and it becomes a hit. Even if, again, a proof of contact is not designated, much of the debate revolves around the ways by which the original filtered up to the big business. And another variant of this first type is located in recording studios, places where someone involved in a production, a session musician, an engineer, a producer, can have access to an original song and copy it or part of it. In all variants of this first type, usually, the song deemed to be a copy of the preceding one is seldom an exact copy. And in some cases, lawyers, consultants, and even judges may suggest the existence of so-called camouflaged plagiarism, that is, a deliberate appropriation where a number of small deviations from the original are introduced in order to mask the copying process. This is a very controversial subject, as it introduces into the debate the supposed intention of the plagiarist. Deviations, of course, may also exist because they stem from different musical ideas or any other reason. There are, anyway, cases of blatant, unmasked plagiarism, which occur especially when the plagiarian work belongs to a rather distant genre from the original, and the plagiarist believes to be safe in his or her niche. For example, dance music while the plagiarized work is a movie soundtrack, or the reverse of this. Distance can also be temporal, when the plagiarized piece is an old song or piece of orchestral music believed to be forgotten or already in the public domain. In the 1960s, there were a number of adaptations, especially in France and in Italy, of the famous adagio from the Concierto de Aranjuez by Joaquín Rodrigo, composed in 1939. Some songwriters imprudently credited the resulting songs to themselves. But Rodrigo was still alive. He died in 1999 and sued them, obtaining that the adapted songs be withdrawn from the market. This is also the case of songs from what used to be called the Third World, copied or adapted, mostly in the 50s and the 60s, by performers who treated them if they were traditional songs in the public domain, while real authors exist. The, probably the most famous case is Wim Away and Booba, but also Banana Boat Song and many others at that time. Another type, the opposite of blatant plagiarism, is so-called cryptomnesia. The unconscious usage of musical ideas memorized by a songwriter in a more or less distant past. Like in the well-known case of George Harrison's My Sweet Lord, copied from Ronald Mack's He's So Fine. It is also known that his colleague Paul McCartney, after composing Scrambled Eggs, later to become Yesterday, hesitated for quite a while to record the song, as he thought to be unlikely that such a simple combination of melody and chord sequence didn't already exist in music history. He said, "For about a month I went round to people in the music business and asked them whether they had ever heard it before. Eventually, it became like handing something to the police. I thought if no one claimed it after a few weeks, then I would have it." In our age, when 30 or more million songs are easily accessed via streaming, McCartney's obsession has become quite common in publishing and record companies. Is the new hit ready to be released bound to be involved in a multi-million plagiarism case by the obscure author of a piece hidden in the long tail? I am not considering in this paper the issue of sampling, because legally, the unauthorized usage of samples is an infringement to another type of copyright, that of the owner of the recording, and also because the analytical methods used in legal controversies are different, but they will be dealt with during this conference by Jovan, I think. Many plagiarism cases are never brought to court. Usually, a case is started by means of a letter from the plaintiff, normally his or her lawyer, addressed to the defendant and his or her publisher and or record company claiming plagiarism. The letter is often accompanied by a more or less detailed analysis of a song drafted by a consultant. The response from the defendant is also normally drafted by a lawyer and accompanied by an analysis. Consultants at this point may be people in the business, friends or collaboration or collaborators of the plaintiff, employees or collaborators of the publisher or record company. When the case seems to be bound to have great economic relevance, experts will see which kind of experts are involved from the start. In its initial phase, a plagiarism case is liquid, so to speak. Often, if the defendant's lawyer feels that the cost of the trial and of requested compensations may become too high, he or she may suggest the client to come to an agreement, a transaction, for a more or less symbolic sum. An average example could be $50,000 compared to $500,000 plus legal expenses. This also happens if plagiarism is so blatant that the defendant's lawyer advises to accept to pay the cheapest compensation possible and avoid to go to court. Due to the concentration of capital in the music industry, it is also more and more common that such transactions be arranged within the same publishing and or recording major, as it happened in a case involving two bands, the British Ocean Colour Scene and Italian Lunapop, both signed for publishing to companies in the Universal Group. So this is one of the songs.
song by the British group.
Sometimes we have thoughts of our love.
For non-Italian speakers to know that un giorno migliore means a better day. I'm sorry. Well, not all plagiarism cases are as straightforward as this, if this was straightforward. Anyway, the author of Un Giorno Migliore claimed that he had written the song before 1996. When a case can be solved with a transaction, it is then passed to a court. This implies the choice of official technical consultants for the plaintiff and the defendant, and, at least in Italy, of a technical consultant of the judge. What kind of consultants? At least in my country, only very few academic musicologists are called for the task. It is much more common to invite teachers of composition in conservatories, or other music schools, or classical composers, which is the same in most cases as composers of modern concert music normally earn their living from teaching. This is not in contrast with the main assumption of this paper, that plagiarism cases put to test methods and theories of musicology, because it can be said that modern classical composers and music teachers in conservatories embody, so to speak, the shared values of 19th and 20th century conventional musicology, through which they were educated, became music professionals, and live every day. Common places like the music work is the score are among the pillars of conventional musicology, be they articulated by Carl Dalhaus or any of his followers, or by a teacher in conventional composition indicating force relations on the blackboard. Composers or teachers in Italy are also chosen because of their solid involvement in music practice, which can't be said, sadly, of all Italian academic musicologists or ethnomusicologists, and also for their prestige, for obvious reasons. A case that mobilized the cream of Italian composers and teachers almost 25 years ago was the one between Albano Carrisi, also known as Albano, with his co-authors, and Michael Jackson. One might expect that Italian experts rushed to support their compatriot, who was the plaintiff. But many among the most prestigious composers accepted to defend Michael Jackson, as Sony has promised a generous donation to one of Italy's best-known music academies if Jackson won the case. The first sentence in 1997 was actually in favor of Jackson, albeit with a statement that both songs were devoid of originality. The sentence was repealed, and then Albano in 1999 won. According to the judge and his technical consultant, there were 37 identical notes in the refrain of both songs. Again, the sentence was repealed and Jackson was discharged, once more on the account that both songs weren't original, and Albano was condemned to pay legal expenses. But before the case was brought to the highest Italian court, Albano and Jackson came to an agreement that included the organization of a charity concert, which never happened. The case is interesting not also for its international and economic scope. The compensation initially requested by Albano was around $2.5 million, but also for the importance in it of two typical theoretical issues: the search for antecedents in order to demonstrate the lack of originality of the supposedly plagiarized work, as well as of the Plagiarian one, and the discussion of compositional techniques, like, in this case, melodic or harmonic progressions that limit the composer's degrees of freedom. Jackson's consultant argued that after the initial notes in a given tonal context, the following notes are obligatory. And so the apparent similarities in the two pieces were the result of the usage of a formula. In my opinion, the court in the second judgment in favor of Albano was also influenced by paramusical aspects, like the fact that Albano's piece was recorded in a studio based in Hamburg, used at that time also by Michael Jackson collaborators, while Jackson's lawyers maintained that Albano's songs were absolutely unknown in the USA. By the way, Jackson's song credits now include an incredibly long list of names, among which Beethoven. After a lawsuit from the Cleveland Orchestra for the unauthorized usage of its performance of the initial part of the fourth movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. The suggestion that one or more of those names and not Jackson could be the real authors of the song circulated informally. On the other hand, as we shall see, some details in Jackson's recording that could have proven decisive for the case in favor of Albano were never considered. So here are the... Sorry. Here are the two songs. You see the list of all. For Jackson, the excerpt from Beethoven, which is nearly 2 minutes, is not included in this example. Jackson said that that was the longest song he ever made, you know, with 2 minutes of Beethoven scenes. So, this is Jackson. Similar melody or the same melody and the same chord progressions and so on. One of the earliest examples being this piece.
Bless you for being an angel, just
title on the record cover is different, but the actual title is Without a G. That the similarities between Albano songs and the two antecedents, Bless You and Darling, were found more pronounced than the similarity between Will You Be There and I Cigni di Balacca. As I have anticipated, there is one detail in both Jackson's and Albano's recordings that could have been a key point in the analysis but wasn't considered at all in the case. It's a distinctive rhythmic feature in the accompaniment, the staccato sequence, not exactly the same. Clearly unrelated to the melodic and harmonic aspects around which the plagiarism case was set up, but quite strangely present in both recordings and not in the other examples. I would define it a Morellian detail from Giovanni Morelli, an Italian art critic from the 19th century, who analyzed minor details in a painting, like the shapes of ears, to identify the distinctive style of a painter and to ascertain the painting's authenticity. Yes. Listen to this. Usually begin with the identification of the piece to be compared, quoting titles, authors, publishers, registration numbers and dates of the deposit with the relevant performing rights societies, if any, titles and codes of release programs, if any. It's a bureaucratic formality that leaves room for considerable ambiguity. The texts alluded to in the apparently innocuous list above are many. The manuscript used for the deposit with the Performing Rights Society. The score archived by the publisher. The published score, if any, and the phonographs. Today, since decades, in popular music, most scores, including those used for the deposit, are more or less accurate transcriptions of the phonogram, which should be considered the primary source, the primary text. But the historical cultural framework of copyright and the droit d'auteur is based on printing. It is also corroborated by conventional musicological ideas about the identification of the musical work with the score. Quite often, technical consultants, lawyers, and the judge are confronted with different texts, a phonogram, a a transcription of it, a rigid, simplified, inadequate in rendering complex sound structures, and even more schematic transcriptions, usually prepared quite quickly during the early phases of production or on the basis of a demo, just for copyright purposes, like the sketch you give to the Performing Rights Society. Authors of such transcriptions, the song's authors or employees of the publisher, often seem to be unaware of the importance of the document they are drafting. In a recent plagiarism case, with the first sentence still pending, the core of the controversy is a riff, which is present in both songs considered, but is missing in all scores. Reference to phonograms in a case like this is mandatory. Conventional musicologists' fixations grab the scene. Days are spent to check transcriptions made by consultants and examine details as if those transcriptions were actually the original work. Unfortunately, as the case is still open, I cannot present examples, but I can suggest a similar example. Just think of a guitar riff overdubbed at a distance of a third, like in many rock songs from the early 1970s, like this. Now, audio tactile one, some would say. But in the discussion of the plagiarism case I am referring to, where the judge's consultant is an academic music historian and the consultant of one of the parts is a composition teacher, hours were spent to discuss which of the guitar lines was the Hauptstimme. The suggestion by those consultants being that the main line would change every two or four bars, like in one of Dvorak's symphonies, which reference to the parts of the first and the second violins. But of course, as the riff doesn't have an elaborate development, the final comment was, it isn't Brahms after all. Yes, it isn't Brahms. But on the other hand, as many conventional musicologists maintain that they have to consider, when they have to consider popular music, everything is already in Bach, or in Mozart, or in Beethoven. The idea that music theory created in the 18th and 19th century around a selected corpus of European, mainly instrumental and mainly German music, be the universal tool to explain music from any epoch, place, genre, culture, is firmly implanted in conventional musicology and in conservatories. Only Italian ones, maybe. I'm finishing this very quick. In a recent case, one of those that have large following in social media, the author of a song presented at the Minor Festival sued one of the most successful Italian pop boy bands for stealing his work in the production of a major hit. The plaintiff's lawyer and technical consultants spoke of camouflage plagiarism, and indeed the case was problematic, involving a number of the most typical interpretive strategies, from quantitative analysis based on probabilistic methods, to the research of antecedents in popular music history, to the comparative analysis of styles. This is the supposed plagiarian song. This is the supposed original. We may think whatever we want about the two cases. It's a difficult case. It could be nothing. However, the sentence, based on the consultancy of a conservatory teacher, discharged the defendants on the assumption that both songs lacked originality. And why? As they were both based on that famous piece by Beethoven's Crosstown. Yes. I mean, it would not be necessary, but, you know, it gives the dimension of the thing. There was shock amongst lawyers who commented that with sentences like this, no plagiarism could ever be proven, as there is always the chance that a certain combination of notes included in a classical piece also appear in a popular song. Everything is already in Bach or any other genius from the past. Actually, looking at the issue with the eyes more than the ears of a classically trained composer, any melody could be hidden anywhere, if you don't consider its context. In another recent case, where the melody of the refrain in a hit by one of Italy's major rockers seems to be copied almost note by note from a dance hit, a consultant, again a composition teacher, found the same notes, I mean, I'm talking about dance piece and a singer-songwriter piece, both in the theme of a Tchaikovsky concert and in one of Bach's best-known choral preludes, by the way, the same that was copied for the organ line of a White Shade of Pain. The point is, however, that these notes are only identical in pitch, because they appear in different contexts, especially they are located on different implicit accents in a bar. If one looks at the score, of course notes are there. But if one hears the music, it takes a while, even for an expert listener, to realize that the melody is similar and not identical, as a melody isn't only defined by pitch. Conclusions. Philip Tagg wrote, thank you, Philip, the founder of IASPM. He wrote, explaining something as common and as ostensibly simple as the La Bamba chord loop, as in La Bamba, Guantanamera, Wild Thing, Pata Pata, Twist and Shout, and so on, in terms of tonics, of dominant and dominant, had for some time struck me as about as productive as using theories of combustion to explain electricity. This observation can be found in the preface of his Everyday Tonality, one of the first efforts to build the harmonic theory of contemporary popular music based on the critical revision of conventional theory. That image of theories of combustion used to explain electricity spread across the writings of popular musicologists with variants like steam engine thermodynamics used to analyze laptop computers and the like. As a matter of fact, Tagg's paradoxical observation becomes reality in the field of forensic musicology. At least in Italy, no tribunal would hire a technical consultant, a hydraulic engineer to examine the faults in a fiber optic network, even if a number of theorems may be common to the subjects. Many conventional musicologists do not consider popular music worth of analytical attention when they don't overtly despise it. But being a consultant for a case of plagiarism may have its advantages.
The University of Huddersfield, inspiring tomorrow's professionals.